Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being here today, and thank you very much to Torch and Yashvili Museum for organizing this. As you can see from this hardly pronounceable title, in this mini talk, we will look at strange words. A few particularly strange words which will allow us to touch the very core of Dante's poetic enterprise. We are on the top of Mount Purgatory. Dante has reached the Garden of Eden, where his beloved Beatrice has appeared and has taken the role of Dante's guide, after Virgil. In the last cantos of Purgatorio, we see Dante's personal process of purification from sin, his repentance, and consequent disposition to proceed to the third and final stage of his exceptional journey through afterlife, heaven. The story told in the third canticle of Dante's comedy, Paradiso, starts in fact in Purgatory. In canto one, after the introduction of the new subject and the invocation of Apollo, we are technically still on the top of Purgatory, but we do not see the landscape of Eden anymore. The only thing that we see is the sky, and the only action that happens in this canto is one gaze, a reflected gaze. Beatrice looks directly at the sun, Dante is induced to look in turn at the sun, but he cannot sustain so much light, and he looks at her again, so that she kind of mediates the action of looking at the sun and at the heavens for Dante. This is how Dante ascends to heaven, simply by looking at his beloved Beatrice, who looks at the sun. Nel suo aspetto tal dentro mi fei qual si fe Glauco nel gustar dell'erba che il fe consorto in mar degli altri dei. Trasumanar significar per verba non si poria, però l'esempio basti a cui esperienza grazia serba. Gazing at her I became within what Glaucus became, tasting the herb that made him a consort of the other gods in the sea. To signify transhumanizing per verba is impossible. Therefore, let the comparison suffice for those to whom grace reserves the experience. By looking at Beatrice, who looks at the sun, Dante feels transformed in a way that is difficult to convey. Therefore, he tries to describe it by means of a comparison, a simile, with a mythological episode, including in Ovid's Metamorphoses. The fisherman Glaucus becomes a sea god by eating a particular herb. And then Dante also tries to give a name to that new filling, which solemnly occupies the first part of the following verse and the center of the entire canto, trasumanar, transhumanizing, to become more than human. But that new verb is basically created to say in the same verse that trasumanar cannot be said. It cannot be signified in literal words. And then the poet directly and humbly addresses the reader, us, to whom the direct example, when they will in turn experience this process after death, will be clearer. Trasumanar is the first neologism, a made-up word of a series that characterizes Dante's Paradiso. In Dante's works, we find the first occurrence of many Italian words, but these neologisms are not my focus today. The series of neologisms in the Paradiso, which I'm talking about, is consistent and strictly integral to that poetry. They are all verbs, mostly reflexive verbs, formed by a combination of a noun, adjective, adverb, or pronoun, with a prefix and the verb ending. The prefix is usually in, indicating movement into something, for example, in celare, to in heaven, or trans, indicating a movement beyond something, such as trasumanar. This series is especially related to the issue of ineffability. What is it? The impossibility to say, to tell Dante's unprecedented experience of the afterlife. This is an issue which characterizes all of Dante's comedy, but which is particularly present in the Paradiso. This canticle, indeed, represents the only realm of the three which is not located on Earth and which is beyond human dimension, space, and time. Here, the problem regards memory, the actual possibility of remembering such an overwhelming experience, and language, the possibility of reporting that ascent. The creation of new words is one of the many strategies adopted by the poet to face this problem. Language, which is a human product, necessarily lacks the means to represent the divine. Classical and medieval rhetoric allowed for occasional linguistic inventions for specific representational needs, but Dante does not restrict himself. The paradisiacal neologisms are 29 in total. Sorry. Not every one of them is technically coined to cover a specific linguistic gap. If we consider the whole series, however, that is a proliferation of language which goes beyond the single need. It is rather a system that serves to set the tone of that representation, to make it clear that a non-existent language is the minimum and the maximum which one can use there. Ed eran tante che il numero loro, più che il doppiar degli scacchi, si milla. There were so many that the number in thousands itself beyond the doubling of the chessboard. These are angels, and the doubling of the chessboard is a reference to a story that was used to represent an infinite number. Se io mi intuassi come tu in me, if I could in you myself as you in me yourself. Daring verbs formed by means of personal pronouns, me and you. This verse highlights the gap between the pilgrim's possibilities as a living human being and the blessed soul's supernatural capabilities. This is the gap between human and divine that Dante tries to cover with his poetry in Paradiso by means of words that literally bring the human subject into the trans-dimension of heaven, and also in the other direction on the same line, the divine object is pulled and encapsulated into a new human world. Infinite is the dimension in depth and breadth which Dante represents in the Paradiso. The in and trans neologisms represent a process of penetration into transcendent entities and of metamorphosis of both subject and object, because Dante is transformed and heaven displays and transforms itself in turn for Dante. On the extension side, they concretely are an attempt of language to enthousand itself, to multiply itself. After we have seen the first of these special words, trasumanar, I would like now to observe the last one, because these two extreme inventions at the ends of the Paradiso somehow epitomize the essence of Dante's poetry in the comedy. As I said at the beginning, they bring us to the core of his poetic challenge. In the final part of Canto 33, the final canto of the Paradiso, end of the poem, Dante experiences the vision of God in three progressive stages. Firstly, he contemplates the mystery of God's multiplicity and unity, and he conveys it with the image of a book, a single volume made of infinite pages. Secondly, he observes the mystery of the Trinity in the form of three equal circles of three different colors which reflect one another, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Finally, within the central circle, the Son, he gets to see our own effigie, the human image. It is the mystery of incarnation which founds Christianity and the actual possibility for women and men to be saved. Quella circulazione che si concetta pareva in te come lume reflesso, dagli occhi miei alquanto circunspetta, dentro da sé, del suo colore stesso, mi parve pinta della nostra effigie, perché il mio viso in lei tutto era messo. Qual è il geometra che tutto s'affige per misurarlo cerchio e non ritrova, pensando quel principio dell'indige, tal era io a quella vista nova. Veder voleva come si convenne l'imago al cerchio e come vi si indova, ma non erano da ciò le proprie penne. That circulation which seemed in you to be generated like reflected light, surveyed by my eyes somewhat, within itself, in its very own color, seemed to me to be painted with our effigy, by which my sight was all absorbed. Like the geometer who is all intent to square the circle and cannot find, for all his thought, the principle he needs, such was I at that miraculous sight. I wished to see how the image fitted the circle and how it inwears itself there, but my own feathers were not sufficient for that. The simile of the impossible squaring of a circle is an attempt to give an idea of the possible impossibility of Christ's double nature. And since this is not enough, the same coincidence between human image and divine circle is condensed in the neologism indovarsi, inwear. Dante has already said come si convenne, how the image fitted. But since we're in front of the mystery of mysteries, it is more than that. A new word is needed. But that new word again, like in the first canto, is immediately followed by a failure. Ma non erano da ciò le proprie penne, but my own feathers were not sufficient for that. First and last canto of the Paradiso, defining borders of that realm, too extreme and pass, a place which is beyond human and which thus requires the pilgrim a change of status, a place which is founded on the mystery of incarnation. A same pattern is repeated in the two cantos. A simile, Glaucus, and here the geometer. A new word, a made-up word. A failure. In these two particular cases, the new word appears as the breaking point of a contextual effort. A breaking point which corresponds to the instant in which the word just created fulfills its signifying duty by covering an area which has not been signifying yet. But exactly by displaying its still visible formation mechanism, its simple basic structure of a newborn compound made of very simple parts, it declares its own ephemerality and weakness. These neologisms are created almost only to indicate temporarily what they cannot signify. However, they also represent the extreme point that Dante's language and human language can reach, the transformation of itself, in order to overcome its own limits. These words are fascinating because they represent at the same time the fragility, the extreme fragility of human language, and the power that lies exactly in the dynamism which that fragility allows. They declare failure by reaching one of the highest points ever attained by poetry. Thank you very much.